This is the Vinnie Jones Show. Football's our religion. Pull up a pew and see what we've got in store for you tonight.
Brian Stein, ex-Luton, ex-Nonce.
And at the time of me scoring him, I thought, yeah, that's a good goal. But people in the future now said what great goals they were.
I'm still with Millwall and West Ham fans. I mean, you guys, you are really most famous for your hooligans, aren't you?
I could play in Holland for a Premier League club, but I went to Holland and wanted something totally different, so I came here.
Well, management now at the stage of my career is very much on the agenda. Obviously, we've got some nice guests here tonight. Terry Neill, probably one of the most influential managers Arsenal have ever had. You got the sack, Terry.
I was actually, on a serious note, John Lyle, who was the other long-term manager in the London scene in those days, we used to meet up every week, really, various games.
You're not blaming it on him, are you?
No. And we kept saying to each other, we're not really proper managers yet, are we? Because we haven't had the sack. And within about 6 months, we both got our wish. So John Lyle and Terry Neill, even though we're not directly day-to-day management now, are proper managers. And I'm extremely proud about that. What I'm also extremely proud about, I must give Arsenal Football Club immense kudos for. It was all handled impeccably. And I feel very sorry for those managers who, since my sacking, which was always the prerogative of Arsenal Football Club, and I'd always said to all of the two chairmen that I'd worked for there, they didn't have to give me a reason. It was their club. I was their manager. Even if they just said, we want to change, that was entirely their decision. I had no ego problems with that at all. And I'm delighted to say the Arsenal handled the whole thing impeccably. And we remain friends to this day. And that's the way it should be. Sadly, I think that is not the way it is today.
Have you ever been involved with a manager getting a sack, Stein?
No, I tried to ring Pleat you a couple of weeks ago, but his phone was engaged. So.
Have you got a couple of sack or not?
Probably. No, I don't think so. We went down in 91 at Luton from the Premier to the first.
Then. And there must be loads of tittle-tattle, he's got to go, this is going to happen, that's going to happen.
Well, there's a few at the moment. You know, well, there was that game with Pleaty 2 weeks ago at Sheffield Wednesday. And as I said, I tried to ring him, but obviously his phone was red hot. And I couldn't get in contact with him.
That was the 0898 numbers.
Oh, was it? Don't tell my missus.
Terry, what happened? What happens when, you know, you see people, you see these managers, we've just seen Jerry Francis, for instance, in the press conference, thanks lads, you see the back of him. What happens to a manager when he does walk out that door? Well, feelings and emotion and...
That takes a bit of time to get over. If you take
Does the check get you over it? The check that follows you out the door?
Well, it helps a bit. Hey, listen, I'm a pro, and I always have been since I was a little boy, and I'm still a pro now. Although the fee for this programme, thanks to yourself, is, you know, whatever. I'll give you the donation a bit later.
That's why you never put yourself up for the
village. The first thing I did was went out for a bit of lunch down the West End with a very good friend of mine who's now the chairman.
When you went in, Terry, did you know it was coming?
Oh, yes. Oh, you've only got to be in the game for about 2 minutes. You know the signs. All the press guys knew. One of the things I'm immensely proud about, the Saturday before I got the sack, I got the sack on a Friday, 16th of December, 19... Well, let's leave that date. You know, it's a while ago.
28.
And... 38. And, you know what's coming. So I cleared out my office the night before because I knew through the managing director that the chairman wanted to see me at 9 o'clock the next morning. I took the view that, well, if I've got this completely wrong and we've been beaten by Walsall at home in the League Cup, so that ain't good. West Brom, of all people, had beaten us 1-0 at home. So I knew, things are getting a bit tight. But a week before, we'd been at West Ham, league game, we're beaten. Because I had such a good relationship with all of the press, we were in that tunnel there, which then was the press room at West Ham, and we're all hedging around what the real question of the day is, when do you think you're going to get the bullet? And all of a sudden I whipped out raffle tickets for a kid's charity out of my pocket. 300 quid I stung them for. You would love that. I knew you'd love that story. And said, there you are, boys. There are some things that are far more important than a game of football or whatever. Took 300 quid off them, stuffed it in my pocket and said, thanks very much indeed. I moved quicker than I ever moved when I was a player. And they're all going, but. And I know what they wanted to ask me. When do you think you're going to get the sack? Well, they didn't have long to wait the following Friday, but I'd never let spoil my lifestyle. Don Howe took over from me, and when I'd said farewell to the staff on that Friday morning, Don said, well, where are you going to go? What are you going to do? I said, I'm going to have lunch with a man called Ivor Arbiter, now the chairman of Hendon, where I'm privileged to be a director. He said, right. He said, I don't want to have anything to do with the press today. Don't want to get involved in that. You know what Don's like. He's not happy with that side of things. He said, I'll join you. So I, to this day, I've got this vision of Don Howe slipping out the back door of Highbury, and he has confessed to me since that when he was on his way down to the tube, because you know what a cheapskate he is, he wouldn't get a cab or anything. he probably had his travel card to get into the job in the morning. He had to nip into one or two gardens when he saw the press coming up. But Don came down, and to his eternal credit, he said, right, you haven't got a job now, son. You haven't got your payoff or anything like that. I'm buying lunch. What would you like to drink? I said, well, we'll start with two or three bottles of Dom Perignon.
Always back on the Dom Perignon. We'll be back in 2 minutes.
Giorgio Hishtrov, Sergio Perini, Stefano Ivanio, Jimmy Hasselbank. The English football register sounds like a foreign classroom. I'm here at Man City's training ground to meet their new Dutch signing, Gerard Wiekens. He's in there changing his boots, and I'm going to meet him upstairs. Gerard, how does playing football in Holland compare to playing here?
Yeah, I can't compare it because I played in Holland in the first division, and for a very small club. And here I play for a big club. Every home game there are 30,000 people watching the game, and in Holland there were 3,000. So it's difficult for me to compare.
What about the climate though? I mean, it's always, as we can see today, it's raining a little bit.
Yeah.
What's it like in Holland?
When before I came to England, they say it's always raining here. And that's true, but in Holland it's also bad weather. So the difference is not so big.
How's the English game received in Holland? I mean, you said earlier, you know, very small audiences, but how do they view it?
I think people here, they live for the club. In Holland, you've got fans, but they are, I think, aged between 15 and 20.
Oh really? So they're not as committed? I mean, fans here range, the ages are all over the place.
When you're 1 year or 2 years old, you wear a city shirt till you're 60, 70. And in Holland, I think it's between 15 and 25.
Now, what do you think England and Holland's chances are will be in the World Cup next year?
Yeah, since I be here in England, England is playing very good, and I saw them a few times, and I think they make a chance. And Holland, they play good, but they always have problems in a great tournament.
What made you sign for Man City?
I played for my old club 9 years, and I was ready for a change. And I could play in Holland for a Premier League club. But I went to Holland, I wanted something totally different. So I came here.
Mm. Now Man City at the moment are not doing particularly well. I know it's sort of still early days in the season. But how does that affect your relationship with the supporters? Because when you're playing a match, obviously you get some verbal abuse, whatever, from the fans if things are not going their way. How does that affect your relationship?
The last two home games, we lost against Huddersfield and Port Vale. And then the fans became angry. That's normal, and it's not nice them to play for them. But it's our own fault, and when we have a few wins, and it will become okay.
How have you been received by the fans?
I think okay. Yeah, it's different here. I get fan mail here in Holland. I didn't, and people talking to you on the street, and yeah, that's very different. But I think they accepted me.
What differences are there playing in Holland and playing in England with regards to things like discipline and how you're managed?
Yeah, in Holland, I played in the first division, and then you can't relegate there. So yeah, it's not exciting when you when you're in the bottom half. And so
does that take away the emphasis of, you know, the enthusiasm of trying to get to the top?
Yeah, because it's more more exciting to when you can relegate or you can win a championship, that then you play for something.
Is that one of the reasons you chose to play in England?
No, that's not another reason.
No,
but and the players in Holland, in the first division, they also have a job besides the football.
Oh, I see. So yeah. They're not completely professional footballers.
No, I don't think they get the money to manage that.
How difficult is that then, holding down a job and trying to commit to football?
Yeah, for some people it's very difficult because they work from 8 to 4. And after that, they have to train 2 hours. So that's very difficult.
That obviously seems to be a problem then. Do you think that's the reason why you don't have as many players and people watching football over there?
I think so, yeah. Because it's not their main job. And it's become more like England now, full full prof. But it's not all players for a club.
Mm. So what's your ambitions for the future?
My ambitions are to play good for City and to go go back to the Premier League.
I'm Mary Parkinson, and tonight I'm with Millwall and West Ham fans, those two great friends from South East London. And I mean, guys, you have a bit of a history with Millwall, but not so much of a recent one. From the 30s it stemmed, didn't it?
It's an old docks thing, which goes a little bit before my time.
Yes, I know, it's a little bit before your time.
70s, no, a little bit about, and even the 80s. And unfortunately, probably still there now with some of our more senior supporters. But as far as I'm concerned, it's not an issue. It's not. The two London clubs might as well be West Ham and Charlton, West Ham and Orient. It's not.
I mean, you're fairly different divisions at the moment, aren't you?
Very much so, yes.
And can you see that lasting?
At the moment, yeah. The way the side's playing, they're awful.
But you're third?
But they're awful, believe you me. We were third last year and the year before. Look what happened. So it's a deja vu every year for us, isn't it?
Because I was talking to a friend of mine who's a Millwall fan today, and he said that, you know, around Bermondsey, everybody is a Millwall fan. I mean, they have the potential for a huge club support down there. But he said he got so fed up, he went to Portman Road, watched Millwall get relegated and boycotted the ground. I mean, he's back there now. But is that air of despondency and sort of disillusionment sort of contagious around South East London?
Well, I've had a taste of success a couple of seasons ago. We made the playoffs twice, lost both home and away in the playoff semi-finals. So you do get a bit brassed off with it, yeah. You start to get a situation where you sold your best players, you're financially in terrible trouble. So people do get a bit pissed off.
I mean, you've got your new chairman and he's saved the club, hasn't he?
But yeah, for a very low price, didn't he? How much did he pay for the club? £2. Yeah?
He's had to put a lot in, hasn't he, just to keep it going?
Not very much. He bought it very cheaply. Anything, he's bought it at a low price, anything that they do, or anything that improves, he'll make money on. I don't think he's a supporter. He's not a supporter, is he?
If you look at Fulham now, they're throwing money left, right and centre at buying players to buy themselves out of the second division, aren't they? I mean, that's what Millwall need to do, isn't it? You've got the youth policy in place there.
Youth policy seems to have died to death.
I mean, Vinnie Jones is now running Millwall, and he was.
And good luck to good luck to Bonzo.
I
think he's going to need it. I think he's going to need it, poor bloke.
Well, he's got the weather in Norwegian, hasn't he? And live TV.
As I said, good luck to him. I think he's going to need it.
And a couple of ex-West Ham players, of course.
Unfortunately.
You've got Kenny Brown, is it Kenny Brown
finished.
You've got?
It's finished. It's honestly, it's seriously not a problem.
That's not the Kenny Brown that we know.
Exactly.
He's not slow.
When did he leave West Ham?
Two years ago. He's doing the blitz. The Luftwaffe
bomb,
Kenny Brown.
We gave you Dale Gordon on loan.
Thanks.
Kenny Brown was never a first team player at West Ham. He was always, he'd come in, he'd fill a hole and that's it for a game or two, that's it.
I wish it wasn't a hole we could fill in the hole, actually. It's a really good idea, dig a hole and fill it in, yeah. Best position.
That's where you'd like to put him in.
Yes, along with Paul Allen as well, yes. With them together.
There he is, past it. Shame, but very good player, but he's now past it.
It's my consolation to us, though, believe you me. Crawling along the wing, it's frightening. Right. But the good thing is you get money sponsoring the Zimmer frames. You get a lot of money in that nowadays. It's good income.
So you have a combination of very old and very young at Millwall, don't you?
That's right. It's the different generations. There's some of them in nappies and some of them are just totally dribbling down their chins and then dribbling down their wings.
Is there a truth in the rumour, though, that news bunny is going to turn out for you this Saturday?
I think might as well do better, as much rabbit as the rest of the players, as our chief of Cockney say.
That's a shame. News opening for him Saturday and all.
It's like it'll be boring. Can we have Bonzi back
as
well?
It's got
to be Ian Dowie. Would you like Ian Dowie? We will pay you to take it in now.
We
will
take it in there,
I'll tell you.
Yeah.
I mean, how?
Somebody out front that can bully play at least. He's too young. Too good looking, too fast, too skillful.
Yeah, definitely.
Scores too often.
Scores far too often for us, yeah. We took Clive Allen from them. Yeah, 50 goals at Tottenham one season, 0 goals for Millwall in 3 seasons. Thanks, Clive.
Yeah. But it was your Russians that were the real spectacular
success. Oh, the
fast talking
Russians, the vodka boys. Yeah, Smirnoff and Vladivar, they were marvellous, they were.
Especially the one who's on his way to the World Cup. Who was very nearly on his way to the World Cup, wasn't he? Sergei Yaren.
In his league at all to play around him. He'd get the ball, beat 3-4 players and he scratches, he would come in and help me. You know, there's no doubt there. Seriously, it was so far different class.
Was that because the manager didn't know how to use him? Do you think he was too good? Because that's the West Ham problem. We've got players too good, actually too good for our coaching setup, which have not got the ability to deal with world-class players. Go back to last year, Florian Radicevic, Panafutre, Ilya Dumitrescu, world-class players. Unfortunately, our coaches, our management, did not know how to use those players. And I just look at the Millwall situation where Sergei Yaren was a genuine world-class player. And he's proved that this year. And I just wonder whether you had a management who did not know how to use him, which is what we had last year with Florian Radicevic, who was another World Cup representative player who was blamed as being a flop, but only because he had a manager not allowed to look after him and use him. I just wanted to do the same thing
Harry Redknapp is a very good. He'd do well down at Millwall. No disrespect to Millwall, he would do to a very small club. Millwall are a small club.
So you don't reckon he is the manager for West Ham?
No. Totally. Anybody that plays Ian Dowie as long as he has and persevered with him. The guy scored one goal in the last 18 months, which myself and Spence were up at Stockport and raining.
That fabulous header.
That was the best header I've seen in 35 years of football.
Yeah, I mean,
unfortunately, it was the wrong goal, wasn't it?
So well for Sheffield Wednesday last season. You had Dowie up front, you had Radicevic, who, like Spence said earlier, is a world-class player. And he had him warming up for 60 minutes. Honestly, halfway through the first half, he was running up and down the touchline.
Well, I mean, I remember when United came down to Upton Park, Radicevic's goal was absolutely out of this world, wasn't it? Fabulous goal.
Is that the year we stopped you winning the league?
No, it wasn't.
Desperate. Yeah. Redknapp was a desperate man, he threw his man on and his man came up trumps. I mean, yeah, that wasn't tactical, that wasn't thinking he's the man to unlock the defence.
We played appallingly badly and ended up 2-0 up.
Redknapp and Radicevic may not have got on.
Did I miss something there?
London United.
Just so
London
that you United. All know, for this half of the programme, I am a Manchester United supporter. So on that note, we're going to wrap this half up.
come after the break. Man City in the 1980s. Jimmy Wagg talks to Sam Allardyce about his days at Bolton. Vinnie sups up with Terry O'Neill and Brian Stein. And the Honourable Mary is back with Millwall and West Ham.
Turn and got it back onto his left foot. Always the danger. Goal manufactured by Kenny Dalglish out of absolutely nothing. Jinked one way, turned the other, doubled back, and the left foot did the rest. Cohen plays it in. Now he jinked to go to one side, then to the other. Now he comes back again. He's lost Caton, and the ball is in at the post.
Half time. Peter Swales retreats to the director's private lounge. Downstairs, there's no rest for the players. Malcolm has them back in the gym.
Push Tony in there, push him in there. You know, as soon as it's in front, you know, you see the situation.
Ground all the time.
Turn it up a bit.
Liverpool are leading 1-0, but it needed all the individual brilliance of Kenny Dalglish to break the stalemate. Dalglish took a pass to Cohen on the edge of the penalty area, with back to goal and Caton on his heel.
Where's Tony? Tony! Tony! Try and make more distance on your runs. Yeah. Now, when you're there, make distance on your right. You don't want to run, Kenny. Yeah. As soon as you get away, accelerate. Yeah.
I'm going down, John.
Again, City closing down the space of the man on the ball, but that man was Dalglish, and he found McDermott. McDermott crosses, and Souness has got another goal. He just can't stop. Is he delighted? It's now 2-0. Graham Souness the score.
16 minutes gone in this second half. Liverpool in complete control, leading by 2-0.
Dalglish for Lee. 5 of them in this break. Lee tries the shot, and what a shot it was too! Beaten by the pace of the shot from Sammy Lee. 3-0 the scoreline, and Manchester City are sunk.
Hanson, A-T-N-S-E-N, Clemens, 6. Cohen, C-O-H-E-N, 6.
Added the final nail in City's coffin.
Joe Corrigan let in 3 goals. Malcolm thought he should have saved at least one.
It's a bad goal. He's not gone in the net about 2 miles an hour. How can that be a good goal? From 20-odd yards.
I see what your point. We're looking at it from the other point of view.
So you're looking at it, you're dreaming up miracles. You're saying he did this, he did it. He turned, he made a little chance and he had a shot. And it's gone like that and it's gone in the net. If it had been anybody else, you wouldn't even mention it.
There aren't many players who can do that.
What? Make the ball bounce.
Yeah, I'm sure there's you that can do that. Yeah. Anyway, we're very different on that one.
The third goal was a good goal. That is a good goal, the third goal. Good goal, fuck me.
Bounce off your arm. We all thought it was only a Dalglish kind of goal, you know, brilliant goal. He's made it from nothing, nothing else. Malcolm doesn't really think so.
Got the double up, Malcolm.
Yeah?
You got the double up, wasn't Palace at the bottom. Not putting pressure on you, know, this is a quiet little private meeting.
I mean, nobody has to put pressure on me, because there's enough.
Don't you think we ought to are we going to stick with these we've got or what? Do you know what I think? Really? What do you think about this one? You won't like this one. Do you know what I think would do well
for us? Don't tell me the answers to my question.
No, I won't tell you the answer. Do you know what I think would do well for us now? He won't do it because I've suggested it, but do you know what I think would do well?
No.
The fella will let go.
Hi, welcome back. I'm Mary Parkinson, and I'm still with Millwall and West Ham fans. I mean, you guys, you are really most famous for your hooligans, aren't you?
Are we?
Are we?
Yes.
Really? No, not at all. Just a journey to the old pint of beer. Yes, we're right old Cockneys. We like an ease up.
The old Kent Road.
Indeed. Some good pubs down the old Kent Road.
Used to be until you thrashed them 5 years ago. Yeah,
well, I mean, you are famous for wanting. I mean, wherever Millwall go, whenever they come up to the West End, when they come to Chelsea, when they come to West Ham, whatever, there is a ruck.
They pick on us.
That's right.
So you are completely innocent.
Chelsea.
I mean, they pick on us wherever we go.
If you remember, the town turns out for us.
They've got a Scottish motto: wherever we go, we fear no foe.
That's
down to him.
I mean,
his ancestors.
You are the only club in the Premier League entitled to wear the lion, aren't you, on your shirt? Because of your Scottish roots.
Indeed, yes. I have my wearing my Scottish roots at the moment, yes. They're below the kilt here, just out of shot, unfortunately.
Shame. Can we get a low one there, please?
If you take this problem of punch-ups, yeah?
Yeah.
You were allegedly at the Chelsea Millwall Cup game a couple of years ago. You saw it was old Chelsea. Nothing to do with Millwall.
No, I didn't go to the game. I watched it on the telly.
Oh, well, obviously you're ringside seated. But you see the newspapers.
And I saw the King's Road the next day.
Tremendous. Well, I've got to buy a frock afterwards, haven't you? But if you look at the pictures you see in the newspapers, it's Millwall riot at Chelsea.
Yeah.
So if Chelsea riot playing Millwall, it's a Millwall riot.
Right.
If Birmingham tried
so
to jump...
So it's all just blame.
We're badly misunderstood.
It's the media. It's
the same thing with the England supporters. I think supporters in Italy, they all got badly done, they got bad press. But the thing is, the reputation goes before. Unfortunately, Millwall... If Millwall, hopefully they'll still be in existence, and I don't mean it's to take the piss, but hopefully they'll still exist in 100 years' time. There's no guarantee, is there? Unfortunately, this reputation will always go before them. And unfortunately, the big games have always pulled out a few meatheads. I mean, you guys go, Tuesday night at Crewe or a Wednesday night at Stockport, and there'll be no bother at all. But the big games, big cup games come out, and the meatheads come out of the woodwork, as I'm sure West Ham fans would if we got drawn in the cup against Millwall in January, third round. They'll be
right, they're out.
Who put you out of the cup this year?
Bristol.
Next question. Bristol, Rover City. I don't know.
But you are sitting third in the table, and you know West Ham here two, and you're two clubs. If your away results have been dire, and your home form has been dire, and if you can pick up, and you actually haven't played that badly away. You've just given away really stupid.
Like we haven't played badly. It's just
the only time we played badly was at Arsenal.
Yes,
that's what happens in this top league. That's what it does happen in that top flight.
You get punished
though. If you don't take your chances, you do not win games. Fact, and that's what we've been doing. We've been going away, playing well. Everyone loves us. They clap us off the pitch. But you don't take chances. You don't. There's no way they'll win games.
How do you rate John Hartson? Because I think he's.
He's as good as they come.
He's only 21. He's got to get at least 50%.
But he can't be expecting miracles on his own.
He's got to be with
we need someone. It doesn't matter whether it's Kitson. You need someone. But like they shoved him up there on his own on Sunday, and Hartson did the best he could, and he didn't play a bad game. But if he's not supported, then we're not going to get anywhere.
Yeah.
So you can't. West Ham can't suddenly become a one-man team, which is what they're rather looking like, or a two-man team.
Old Trafford.
Maybe after Christmas we might be a one-man team.
Old Trafford this season, we scored first, obviously, against your team.
Yeah.
About two minutes later, we could have gone 2-0 up.
Yeah, you should have gone 2-0 up.
If we'd have gone 2-0 up, it would have been a totally different game of football.
Yeah.
We'd have got 3 points. Everybody said, West Ham, it was lucky. It was a lucky result. It wasn't. You won 2-1. And it was a travesty of justice. We should have had at least a point.
But it's been like that. That proves it completely. However well you play, if you don't take your chances, you don't win games.
How do you solve the problem? I'm
fucking
like solved.
30 odd years that I've been watching West Ham. We go to West Ham to watch the football. We have a laugh. And but like Arsenal supporters, Chelsea supporters, they all turn around and say, oh, we got beat, and it's wrong. It isn't wrong. If you get beat, we get used to getting beat.
Yeah.
It's fun if you get beat.
Steve, I'd chip in there, though. I would half like to see us win something, though.
Oh, so would I. I'd love it.
I mean,
I would half like to see us win something.
Mary, I'm very interested in what you're going to say. You say that we are good away, bad at home. They are good at home, bad away. We should combine the clubs.
Yes.
So we're good at home and away, and they're shit home and away. I don't agree to that.
And Millwall would be in the first division.
Yes, bring on Real Madrid, that's what I say, as long as they're not too rough.
Who's next? Barcelona, who've got the fans who are modelled on England fans, aren't they?
No, Italy.
Italians, the Greeks
who fire guns into the air and kill their sons. I mean, that was tragic, wasn't it? Absolutely
diabolical. Yeah. But see, no one makes a big thing of that. In England, a football game, there's a fight between five or six players or people on the pitch or on the terracing, and it's bad. It's written all over the world.
Yeah.
Like one guy shoots a guy in Turkey, and it's a 2-0. It's a little thing. It's a small little thing. In England, they reckon it's an England disease. But
that goes back to the publicity of years ago, though. Because any little thing brought up, it'll get glamorised by the press.
It's a worldwide thing.
Which is the Millwall thing.
Press are awful, aren't they?
We travel away. Every game, basically, when we travel away, it's like an A game to an A class. It's a graded A game, you know, with the police. They are bang out to basically give us a hard time. Irrespective, it could be Bishop Stockley in a cap, you know, or, you know, anybody. They just want a good day out, get lots of overtime.
Yeah, the police rub their ass.
Bristol City Saturday, last Saturday, I didn't go. You get reports or so from papers or whatever. The police, it was reporting in the paper that basically the dogs and everything was at the north end of the ground. Not looking at the Bristol City fans, who are, you know, as game as us, basically. Well, we all know, everybody knows what it's like. They allowed the home fans to torment and do what they like. I went to Preston, second game of the season this year. I'm standing there with a friend of mine, and the Preston fans are next door to us. They're gobbing at us, and the abuse they're throwing at us. We had four young kids, 12, 13, down the front, giving a bit of verbal back. Two of them get carted out. I actually pulled the inspector out and said, what are you doing? I said, they're gobbing, grown men gobbing us all through the game. What are you going to do about it? He said, go and stand over there, mate. Do as you tell.
That's the England-Italy thing. England-Italy was exactly the same. Yeah.
North, we get, you know, they don't like cockneys. It's as simple as that.
But unfortunately, you can't hide behind the fact that, the cops are right up for it. Again, the Italy thing is exactly the same. But... and the reason where they've got it from is the books they read, the newspapers they read, where your bad press is coming out, which is a nasty business.
What I would like to say is there's three Millwall fans there, three West Ham fans. We've sat here half an hour, not a bad word said between us. We'll go and have a drink afterwards, no problem.
Excellent, and on that happy note, we're going to wrap this one up. Thanks, guys.
Coming up, we talk to the scorer of this.
Goal!
Sam Allardyce. And Vinnie Jones gets the beers in.
Nowadays, every footballer has an Italian suit and a mobile phone. It used to be different, forwards used to be flashed, and defenders used to sort out forwards. Sam Allardyce was a defender. So Sam, the new Reebok Stadium, what do you reckon?
Well, Jim, absolutely fantastic. It's my first time here at the Reebok Stadium, and I've seen it from afar, obviously still living in Bolton, and I've seen it progress over the last 12 months or so, but to actually come inside it for the first time, I'm thoroughly impressed with the whole setup.
Are you surprised that Bolton have made it back to the top flight? You had a great team at the end of the 70s. You had one little dart at the Premiership a couple of years ago, which ended in disaster. But they were swanning about in Division 4 not so long ago, and the progress they've made, does it surprise you at all?
I have been surprised, to be perfectly honest, because I was caretaker manager of Preston at the time. We played Bolton. We actually drew that game 2-2. Bolton then went on to get promoted that year and have gone on from strength to strength from there. And I think it's all credit to everybody at the football club, really. I mean, the foresight of this stadium with the directors and the council, the good management team that they obviously had then in Bruce Rioch and Colin Todd, and some wise spending. And certainly this time, with the income and the Premiership money, and the fact that Colin Todd has picked up a couple of useful Premiership players and looking to even add to that squad, I think with this stadium and the squad they've got, they'll survive easily this season.
Now, after you left Bolton, you played for quite a few clubs, but is Bolton still the first result you look for?
Yes, the first result I always look for, and the club closest to my heart. My relationships in football are kept by the people I played with here, like Peter Reid and Mick Walsh and Paul Jones, Frank Worthington, Roy Greaves and Seamus McDonough, and all those players that I regularly can keep contact with. And Bolton were a successful side really by the fact that Ian Greaves bought some good experienced players like Frank Worthington, Alan Gowling, Willie Morgan, Peter Thompson. But there was a young nucleus of players that came through together, like myself, Paul Jones, Don McAllister, Peter Reid, Neil Watmore, all those type of players. And we had a fantastic team spirit and a great blend. And, you know, we went on to eventually achieve our goal by winning the championship, but it took us 3 years to do that.
Did you know that you were involved in something a bit special? Did you feel it coming together?
I always felt that the team spirit was a bit special. I think I was a bit naive to how much it meant to everybody in the town. People, even today, when I walk around the town, bump into me and say, "Big Sam, what about that goal against Sunderland?" And it's only later on in life that I realised how much it meant. As a young man, I just wanted to play football and enjoy my football.
When you were playing for Bolton, you were a defender, but you had a reputation for scoring fairly spectacular goals and getting them all on TV as well, didn't you?
People do remember those goals. And at the time of me scoring them, I thought, yeah, that's a good goal. But people in the future have now said what great goals they were. And, you know, I'm really chuffed that people do remember them.
I seem to remember, though, your version of the celebration wasn't quite what it is these days. You didn't do duck walks and stuff. Nobody saw Big Sam Allardyce doing the duck walk, did they?
No, you probably saw two hands up in the air with a big smile on my face and about three or four of my teammates on my back that I'd try and carry back to the halfway line. So, you know, yes, we enjoyed every goal that we scored. And may I say, I mean, I think the celebrations of goals today are exciting me. And I like to see, you know, a little bit of foresight into celebrating a goal. Unfortunately, today it can't be off the pitch because we might get arrested.
But when you're managing clubs, no disrespect, like Knox County, where you're picking the team, virtually marking the pitch out, when you were a player playing at the level you did, well, let's face it, you'd have been pretty cosseted, wouldn't you? Turn up at this time, we'll take you to the game, we'll put you in the hotel. Do you ever think, oh, flipping heck, I could do without this?
Sometimes, yeah, especially when I'm driving up and down the motorway, which might be like 11 and 12 o'clock at night when you've got
don't
to go
you have
out
a driver
and watch
then?
It. Not really, no. We don't even have a scout where we are. You know, I've got to keep in contact with the game at every level as much as I possibly can, because my job rests on me bringing better players into Notts County, or developing young players better than we are. We haven't got any money to spend, and, you know, my job is getting on the road and looking at players. And sometimes when you get back late at nights and you've had a full 12-hour day, 6 or 7 days a week, sometimes it gets a bit tiring, but the ultimate is the Saturday or the Tuesday night when the team go out on the field, put up a good performance and come off with 3 points. And you know, that is one of the best feelings you can have in football. It's not too long ago that Notts County were in the old First Division, which is now the Premiership, and their demise has been very rapid, just as Bolton's actual success has taken off in the last 4 or 5 years. So Notts County is a big club. We have a 20,000 all-seater modern stadium built about 5 years ago, and my ambition is to get them as high as we possibly can, and who knows, maybe hopefully in the Premiership. But you know, one day I'd like to test my skills at this level.
Well, we're dragging our heels in it a little bit today. We've had to bring in another life member of Luton.
Got it.
Sid the Elevator Man. and if you watch our show in the new year, we'll tell you why he's the Elevator Man. We've also got Brian Stein, another Luton Well, he played like a supporter, actually, some people might say. And, of course, we've got Terry Neill on the question of managers. Sid, just thought I'd bring you in. We're talking with Terry there about managers going, coming, one, yeah. You know, you've been at Luton a long time, and Steeney's been there in the glory days. You've mm-hmm. been there, obviously.
Yep.
You know, where do you see as a supporter what happens to a club? You know, I mean, it was flying high with Pleaty and that.
Sure. Well, I suppose times like this, it's sort of easy to slag off the chairman, the manager, the players.
No, feel free, it's that sort of show.
That's what I'm going to do.
All of them.
I'm about to start slagging off the chairman.
Remember your membership.
Now, I think, make a couple of points, really. I suppose, really, a club, particularly in this competitive environment of football today, does need investment in the players. And it's all right, as far as we're concerned, looking forward to a possible new site for our ground, but first and foremost we're a football club and we've got to get our team sorted out. So I think, having said that, we've got a situation where, understandably, the boys needed to pick themselves up from a disappointing season last year, having got knocked out of the playoffs, and we anticipated this year that it might be tough for us to start, but at the moment we're in a situation where probably, I think I can say, we're the weakest Luton side that I've seen since I've been supporting the club.
See, that's the problem. You must be thinking to yourself, go and find a Steeney, go and find a Mick Hartford, go and find a Steve Foster.
To name at least three or four.
Yeah. You know, I mean, there are a lot of good players that have come out of
that's right.
John Artson.
Yep.
You know, why did they let John Artson go?
Well, again,
I mean, it was a lot of money. It was good business at the time for Luton. But then if you know the
who have
success,
we got now to replace?
As you're saying, they're on about moving their ground, one thing and another, but it's got to come down to game day, isn't it? It's got to come down to saying, well, let's get it right on the pitch and let's go and get a lovely stadium.
That's right. And I think, apart from anything else, we've always been known, quite rightly so, as a footballing side. I mean, we've got a couple of Watford supporters in here at the moment. You normally tell them they're looking up at the ceiling all the while. And,
Oi, I don't know. Oi, I was there.
I know you were.
Schoolboy, I was a schoolboy.
I know you were. But I think we're in a situation. I think we're in a situation now.
And you haven't lost it.
I ain't lost it over 20 years.
I think we're in a situation now where the division that we're playing in calls for a modification of our football.
You need the plastic turf back. That's the only way you're going to get out of it, isn't it?
As long as that doesn't bring back Mr. Evans as well, possibly, yeah. He had some good ideas, but no, we don't want the plastic back. We want a team that's got some substance to it and is
David
playing
Clint?
As a team.
Would you have him back?
Well, I always liked David. I mean, he's known as Mr. Luton, and I think that probably will always... I always...
Only on that red light dish.
I always thought... I thought we were talking about football, right? Not hobbies.
Well, balls are balls,
yeah,
aren't they?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. I've always admired him, and I've always thought he's at his best when actually building up a team of developing players as opposed to necessarily buying players in. And funnily enough, we were just talking about managers leaving and being let go and so on and so forth, and no names, no patria. But we hear that a certain manager recently dispensed with by a Premier side was told over the phone that he'd be going.
I mean, come on, then. Come on.
Well, it's not for me to
give a couple of clues.
A couple of clues.
Not for me to mention names, really, is it?
A clue. Give us a clue. We're working out.
Steeney are working out.
Well, I mean, if I said sort of gave a hint like pleated skirts or something like that, and you have to get a cryptic message and try to work it out for yourself without mentioning any names. Cutlery, your start to the team. Yeah.
Scotty, isn't it?
That wasn't so much a clue as a surefire answer, eh? Why didn't you just say that?
But,
he just wants to come back to Luton.
No, to say it would be wrong for me, for any Luton supporter, to sit here and say bring back David. In other words, Lenny, you haven't.
But it sounds like you want him to come back.
Well, I think you get to a stage, really. We've just lost our four home games on the trot, and we've been knocked out of the cup for the first time in the first round of 67 years by third division side. I suppose sometimes a manager might have to take stock of the situation, as Gerry Francis recently did, and said, well, OK, fine, perhaps time for a change in an approach. We've just changed the team coach. Wayne Turner has now taken over as team coach. But is that tinkering with the situation? I think we've got to modify our football because of the division that we're in.
But what do you, but Sid, what do you want? Do you want them to change to get up the league? As you're saying, would you be happy with them going up the league playing like Watford? Or staying down there playing like Luton are at the moment?
Well, I don't think we would ever play like Watford any more than Watford would play like us. But I think in the division that we're in, it calls for a modification of fast passing balls, when possibly the players in terms of youth and so on and so forth are not up to that. And every now and again, chasing a long ball is no bad thing. And that
but
comes
you're
from the
keep your membership, Sid?
Absolutely, yes.
We'll be back.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, that's it for this week. Join me next week for more bickering, shouting, screams. Back down the boozer with my mates. Don't miss it.